A big area of questions and challenges in permafrost, but we are now moving towards a different kind of application. It's about landslides. As regards instruments and measurement technology, I think landslides are much more easier, but in fact its interpretation of the data is still also a challenge, and it's a pleasure for me now to announce Jonathan Chambers to give his keynote lecture about landslide monitoring.
Good morning, everyone. It's very, very good to be here. What I'm going to do in the next few minutes is to look back at really 10 years of monitoring at our Holling Hill Landslide Observatory that we set up back in 2007. And what I want to do first off is to acknowledge a large group of researchers whose work I will be presenting. So, in terms of the structure of the talk, I will begin by outlining our motivation for setting up this landslide observatory. I'll describe the site and look at some of the reasons why we selected it. I'll then go on to describe the methodology we've followed in our research at the site, really seeking to see how electrical methods, ERT in particular, can contribute to the early warning of landslides. I'll present some highlights of the research and then take a future look. And in terms of our overarching objective, it's very broad. It is simply to develop geoelectrical methods for landslide characterisation and monitoring. If we look at this quote by Duncan and Wright, 2005, very helpful, except for the effects of water and clay soil, slope failures would be extremely rare. And really, this is our justification, if you like, of using ERT and geoelectrics due to the sensitivity to moisture within slopes. So one of the key hypotheses that we were seeking to test was that geoelectrical methods can detect hydraulic precursors. Precursors is really important. Precursors to failure, thereby providing early warning of landslides. So in terms of the site, it's located in northern England, so just up there in North Yorkshire. It's on a sort of a fairly gentle hill slope, consisting of Lias Group mudrocks. Okay, and you can see the mudrocks running around the valley side there. And it's an area that is very prone to landsliding in these Lias Group rocks. The landslide is pretty slow moving, and it's quite complex. You know, there are various processes, some moving processes going on there. And in terms of the scale, we're looking at about 150 metres from top to bottom, and then landsliding extends many hundreds of metres along the hill slope. Here we can see a sort of detailed geomorphological map of the study area. You see the backscarp running along the top, characterised by rotational failures, and the translational zone in the mid-slope, and a number of earth flows, quite well-developed earth flows, further down the slope. And you see by the pink areas, particularly recent activity of the landslide. And much of our monitoring was focused within this area, but I'll go on to talk about that in a moment. So here we've just got some photographs of this site. Starting at the backscarp here, you can see one of these sort of shallow rotational failures. And then further down the slope, we have these sort of mud flow type or earth flow type features. Very broken up, heavily fissured material. A good question to ask is maybe why did we choose this as a sort of long-term landslide observatory or research site? Well, there are a number of reasons. First of all, the material type, the Lias Group mudrocks. They were a real problem in the UK, and therefore this site was, if you like, representative or typical of many of the landslide issues we face in key areas of the UK. Secondly, this site has shown consistent failure over many years. What we didn't want was a site where we could be monitoring for many years with no movement or activity at all. So we wanted a site where we could really study active processes. It's fairly slow moving. And one of our concerns was that for rapidly moving landslides, geophysical instrumentation, equipment, arrays can very quickly get destroyed. Whereas on this site, where we're looking at tens of centimetres, maybe a metre or two per year, we were able to maintain our geophysical instrumentation in reasonably good order. So several different processes occurring, including rotational failure, translational failure. So an interesting system, so quite a bit going on. It was also a site that was accessible and available long term. And these sorts of access issues are a significant concern when you're trying to develop these long term monitoring projects. And it's a site in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the countryside, where there are no planned interventions. No one's going to try and remediate the site or prevent processes happening. So it's a site where we could just look at natural processes taking their course. So over the years, people have proposed different frameworks or methodologies for the geophysical investigation and monitoring of landslides. Just a couple of examples. The first, or one of the earliest that we've come across, is by Buchanan Forster, where they suggested that geophysics can contribute to the 3D definition of landslide geometry, the definition of hydrogeological regime, and the detection and characterization of movement. Later examples, including Contrieri, Tal 2013, which I believe is from the SafeLand project, proposed a more holistic, if you like, framework for landslide monitoring, extended way beyond just geophysics. So, but their approach included design, monitoring, forecasting, and education. But really, sort of key features of these sorts of approaches are that we have a characterization, sort of understanding subsurface heterogeneity, implementing monitoring for the purpose of forecasting, and then communicating, whether it be early warning or some indication of landslide risk and hazard. And what I want to do now is just try and put our work at Hollin Hill and then see how it fits into this framework here. To do that, I've got this sort of table. So we have the four elements of design, monitoring, forecasting, and education. I want to look at what the objectives of geoelectrical monitoring might be in this context, how geoelectrics can contribute directly, and then the challenges involved in deploying geoelectrical techniques in this context. So in terms of design, we'd hope that geological methods respectively can contribute to the development of a 3D ground model. In terms of monitoring, using it to look at ground motion and hydraulic processes. In terms of forecasting, detecting subsurface precursors to landsliding events, and then the provision of information relevant to early warning. Now in terms of the specific contributions, where we have 2D, 3D resistivity for developing ground models. For monitoring, just looking at the raw resistance data, we found can be incredibly useful in looking at precursors to failure events. Then also ERT and the use of ERT to look at soil moisture dynamics. In terms of forecasting, so we're looking at trends in these data, linked to geotechnical properties, and then the provision of near real-time information to inform or provide early warning. Now to think about some of the challenges that we've had to address at the Hollin Hill Observatory, and these are common, I know, to many other studies that have gone on around the world. First of all, the integrated interpretation of geophysical data alongside many other data streams, including structurally constrained versions of seismics. the development of suitable monitoring instrumentation, various corrections that need to be applied in terms of temperature, moving electrodes, and then attempts to try and quantify some way of moisture distribution from this different data. In terms of forecasting, we've been looking at things like pattern recognition within geophysical data, critically looking at thresholds for failure, and then looking further into the future, using geophysical data to input into hydrological and geomechanical models. And then on the communication and education side, developing means of providing geophysical information for the purpose of early warning through web dashboards, automatic processing, and the like. So just to pick up on some of these challenges, to provide examples of the work that we've been doing, first of all is the development of 3D groundwaters by bringing together 3D resistivity at a range of scales and with intrusive data and allied data sets. The use of complementary methods such as seismics, PNS wave tomography, yeah, looking at Pratt's ratio, illuminating the particularly wet sort of whippy mudstone material, and then using these data to structurally constrain our resistivity inversions, with the ultimate goal of developing a detailed ground model for the site on which we could base the design of the monitoring system. So the first step in the process, if you like. Now, in terms of monitoring instrumentation, we focused very much on these two lobes of the landslide. We wanted a sort of a manageable area in terms of scale. We were aware that these two lobes were particularly active, so it would provide some good targets for monitoring activity. You can make out this large sort of rectangle here, that's our ERT monitoring grid, with a series of marker pegs here marking particular lines. So here we have the design of the ERT monitoring array. So each one of these lines from top to bottom contain 32 electrodes, and they were installed in segments, so that if one segment broke due to landsliding, we could very easily replace just a small section of the monitoring installation. So lots of intrusive installations as well, in terms of accelerometer arrays, bore holes, tilt meters, moisture content sensors, and the like. I should also say that this middle array contains a line of 32 SP electrodes that we've been monitoring for the last 10 years. And it's only now that we've found the time to start looking at those data. Here we have the installation of the arrays, 100 equipment wire. Here we have one of the SP electrodes and stainless steel electrodes. And what we found is that even after 10 years of monitoring, these arrays are still functioning very well. So our old ERT monitoring system, the alert system there, that's been again running at the site for 10 years without any trouble at all, powered by solar and a fuel cell. What we found is that during critical periods for monitoring, during the winter when it was very overcast and foggy, the solar panels were letting us down, so the fuel cell was really important. And this system's been operating continuously, 72,000 a minute, so delivering many, many hundreds of data sets. And what we found in developing this site is that the establishment of a field observatory has generated lots of collaborations, so lots of allied sensor types and the development of novel methods in terms of seismics, acoustic sensing, soil moisture sensing using compost arrays, and UAV type research as well, which has been very helpful. The key challenge we identified early on was that of moving electrodes on the landslide. So we'd installed a monitoring system that's designed for remote monitoring, so we didn't have to be on site to monitor the processes. But of course we need to know the geometry of the electrode array And if the electrodes are moving, then we're going to get distorted images as a result of that. So how could we update the geometry when we were not physically present on site? So we looked at a couple of different approaches for that. The first was to interpolate electrode positions based on GPS measurements made on a coarse grid of marker pegs that were surveyed maybe every 6 weeks or so. And this was work by my colleague Seb Willerman, using a range of different interpolation approaches. And what he was able to establish is that even with these sort of very sparse measurements of space and time, he was able to remove most of the artifacts from the ERT images. The second approach was to invert for movement. So Paul Wilkinson started this work in 2010, looking at electrode displacements on a 2D ERT line, so just one of these lines within monitoring array. So inverted for displacement first, and once we've corrected or updated the geometry of the electrode file, the resistivity inversion can then be carried out. More recently, he's implemented that in 3D, and then Loke, very recently, has undertaken a combined electrode displacement and resistivity inversion, so treating the position of electrodes as a variable in the inversion. And these approaches are particularly helpful. They remove artifacts, and crucially, provides information on electrode displacement that is a useful data stream in and of itself. So we can treat the electrodes as a motion sensing grid in effect. And these inversion approaches don't rely on GPS measurements, which is also a big advantage. And what we found so far is that the accuracy is within about 4% of electrode spacing. So 1 meter electrode spacing is just a few centimeter sort of like resolution, if you like, which is pretty good. For short scale monitoring, this accuracy can improve to just a few centimetres here. This is with a 5 metre electrode spacing, but we're still detecting this consistent movement that correlates extremely well with our GPS measurements and accelerometer and torque array measurements made at the site. So looking at petrophysical relationships, if you like, an attempt to calibrate resistivity images in terms of moisture content. And what we did here was to take representative samples from the various lithologies that we had at the site, developed relationships that we used, if you like, to calibrate our resistivity image information in terms of gravimetric moisture content. And moving on to looking at planar thresholds, this is a little animation produced by my colleague Seb, showing the hill soil. What you can see is our imaging volume there on the right hand side of the field. So the resistivity baseline image, you can see the sandstone towards the base of the slope, and then the Whitby mudstone, the lias mudrock that is failing at the site. You see the two lobes of clay just there. It's sort of dipping back into the slope at 5 or 6 degrees. And here we can see it recast in terms of moisture content. And looking here at moisture content changing over time, looking at drainage pathways and patterns within the slope, which has allowed us to begin correlating moisture distributions with specific failure events within certain areas of the slope. So what we've been able to do is to isolate volumes within the model and look at moisture content trends over time, which we found to correlate extremely well with the point sampling and measurements that we've undertaken using various other sensor types. And by looking at the changes and correlating these with movement events, we're beginning to get to the point where we can start establishing some thresholds at which we can anticipate failure events beginning to happen. Okay, in terms of a future look, you'll see I've colour-coded these challenges just in a very broad sense. The green represents, I guess, areas that we're more confident over. The research base is more established. But as we get towards the orange and reds, I would suggest that areas where a lot more research is still needed. But I want to, just to conclude, I want to think particularly about the near real-time delivery of information, a very practical concern for this sort of early warning approach. And it's really the automated filtering and processing and web delivery I just want to mention now. So we're also developing a new instrument, which is the focus of my poster, called the Prime instrument, a very low-cost, low-power instrument for slow monitoring. A critical element of the system is this automated processing and information delivery. So just to look at what we're doing in this area. There are pre-existing geotechnical web dashboards for delivering point sensor information, so tilt and moisture content, for example. These are quite well established in industry. They often have a GIS front end, so you see the various monitoring sites here. You can zoom in on the monitoring sites and you can see the sensor distributions. And you can interrogate each sensor. By clicking on it, you can see how properties have changed over time. We have a dashboard where you can set property thresholds that will generate alarms. And what we've done in the last year or two is to integrate geophysical data into this web dashboard environment, so we can interrogate our 4D geophysical data. In effect, the software treats each voxel or pixel within the image as an individual point sensor. We can set thresholds for generating alarm states for each cell. We can look at volumes within the model and look at how properties have changed over time, and again set alarm thresholds. So that's the direction of travel we're moving in terms of information delivery for ERT. So just to summarise, we've been working at this site for 10 years now, using it to develop geometrics for landslide characterisation and monitoring. Key elements have included 3D ground model development, monitoring instrumentation, and then the data processing workflow, including various corrections for temperature and movement, and looking at calibration and failure thresholds as well. Key challenges for the future are just turning ERT into a practical solution for people dealing with unstable slopes through information delivery. And I think what we've found is that 10 years certainly isn't enough, and there's an awful lot more work still to be done. But anyway, thank you very much for listening.
Well, thank you very much. Nice paper, and of course the big challenge here is not doing the measurement, the big challenge is doing the interpretation and defining the thresholds, because basically what we found out is thresholds are also very different from landslide to landslide, and also from period to period, so it's still a big challenge to work on thresholds. I can say maybe we are not even very close to thresholds, Still a long way to go.
I agree, it's always going to be very site specific. And I think what we found at this site, with many years of monitoring, is that there's quite a long training period, or learning period, to go through before you can begin to start anticipating a movement based on geophysical measurements.
Are there any questions, comments?
Yeah, thank you, Jonathan, for this excellent overview of kind of all this work that you did over the years. Actually, I was also happy to see that the old alert system, which I remember from the alert project, is still running. That is really impressive, collecting data. So basically I have two questions. So one is, you mentioned that you're also collecting the SP data, and from what I kind of talked about this morning, so I would be interested also the value. Maybe you mentioned that you only started now, maybe looking into some of the data sets in more detail and so on, but could you already comment on the value, the benefit that you see in this type of data with regard to also the forecasting, maybe kind of precursor potential? So that's been one question, and the other what is the state regarding linking then also the monitoring data with hydromechanical models? You also had that on one slide, that this is obviously also an important component with regard to forecasting. So what is the state of that? Thanks.
Okay. In terms of the SP, I mean, it's just very easy to collect. So we've had this data logger running with these 32 electrodes for all these years. And it's too early to say anything substantive, I think, about the results, except that even from a cursory inspection of the data, there are some really interesting SP features relating to rainfall, good correlations there, and also some extremely interesting features associated with failure events and the motion of the landslide. But beyond that, I wouldn't like to say too much. It's an incredibly rich data set, very dense data set that we're dealing with. And we installed the array in such a way as to allow potential for tomographic imaging as well, using the SP data. In terms of the linked modelling, again, it's very early days. We have a PhD student who's starting in October with Andy Bindley, seeking to sort of dip our toes in the water of what might be possible with this. But we're certainly aware that in the civil engineering sort of community, sort of geotechnical community, these geomechanical models looking at factor of safety are really significant. And we are wondering whether or not near real-time geophysical data, spatial data, can allow us to better appreciate heterogeneity within these slope stability models. That within civil engineering, they're generally perhaps oversimplified in terms of complexity. And also, by the provision of near real-time data, could we get to a stage where we can provide near real-time updates in terms of factor of safety? So that's our thinking, but at a very, very early stage.
I also think one of the problems that we have with landslide is that they are not always moving. So we need events. We want to investigate, and as you told us, 10 years. 10 years seems to be a long period, but if you are in a landslide, you have to do long-term monitoring. But what if there's no event? Google finance research where you don't see any event, but you need to stay there. Usually it's not the way, okay, you see a landslide, you go there to monitor and then you stay there. So basically this is too late, you need to be there before, but then waiting for maybe 20, 30 years for some events, it's very difficult. And I think it's definitely a challenge to find also some resources to finance a very long period monitoring.
Indeed. There are periods at this site of 2 or 3 years where there's nothing at all. And I guess over, looking back over the 10 years, maybe we've had 3 or 4 very significant movement events. But then we've also had quite long periods of very, very slow processes in print that have also been very interesting.
But I think it's also a topic that we need more and more case studies. So it's also open for a discussion. You're great that you need a larger community to collect many samples and to have a good overview maybe on the landslide of Europe. So we need to have many case studies, many events, and then finally we can work towards triggering values and precursors.
Mm-hmm.
Some more comments, questions? Okay, then I had on the chair to Stefan Zeiler, because unfortunately I have to leave to my ministry.
Thank you, Robert. Before we starting the poster session, we have another series of short presentations.